Since the day the iPhone was released back in June of 2007, Verizon customers and frustrated AT&T customers have been asking the same question. When will Verizon get the iPhone? Well, after nearly 4 years of hot and heavy rumors, the day has finally arrived. Hi, I'm MJ with iFixit, and what I'm holding in my hand is the long-anticipated Verizon iPhone. It looks very similar to the AT&T iPhone, but we know that it's what's on the inside that counts, and our curiosity will not be satiated until we've totally stripped the device and laid its unmentionables bare for the world to see. So, I'm delighted to give the Verizon iPhone iFixit's customary teardown treatment and answer the million-dollar question, just how repairable is it? If you're looking for information about the differences in capabilities between the two phones, there's already a whole lot of that information out there, so I'm going to focus on the differences in hardware. Let's get started by a quick comparison between the two phones. This one is the Verizon, and this one is the AT&T. The first thing that I notice is that the Verizon doesn't have a space for a SIM card. That's because Verizon doesn't use SIM cards. Another obvious difference is that the Verizon iPhone is missing the FCC and Do Not Throw Your iPhone in the Trash logos. And if you can read the teeny tiny text, the model numbers are also different. The AT&T is A1332 and the Verizon is A1349. There have been some changes made in the placement of the antenna bridges on the Verizon iPhone. But interestingly enough, the death grip spot remains in the same location, so it'll be interesting to see if the Verizon iPhone suffers the same issue as the AT&T. Not surprisingly, the Verizon iPhone shipped with Pentalobe screws, which we're well prepared for. If you intend on removing the Pentalobe screws, you'll want to get either our iPhone 4 Liberation Kit, or if you're looking for something more professional, our high-quality Pentalobe driver from our tool store. The teardown process for the Verizon iPhone is almost identical to the process for the AT&T iPhone, so let's get this phone taken apart and take a look at what makes it different. To get started, let's take out those Pentalobe screws. There. Okay, so it's disassembled, and I'm actually kind of surprised. It is quite a bit different on the inside. The first thing that I noticed was that the vibrator has been moved to a completely different location. It used to be in this corner up here, and now it's kind of down near the battery connector. Probably the biggest difference is that it's 3 or 4 times bigger than the previous vibrator, and in testing it, it actually felt a bit softer, and it was quieter. I don't really know that I would notice it if it were going off in my pocket. Another thing I noticed is that the batteries look almost identical, but the connector is different, and that's kind of unfortunate because that means right now the parts aren't interchangeable. The same thing goes for the rear panel, although the rear panel looks almost exactly the same. If you compare the inside of this rear panel to the AT&T rear panel, they don't match up. So until we let you know otherwise, so far the parts aren't interchangeable. The biggest difference is that the Verizon iPhone runs on CDMA, whereas the AT&T iPhone runs on GSM. Let's talk about what that means for a minute. GSM is faster, but CDMA is more reliable, so what that might mean is that you'll notice fewer dropped calls on the Verizon iPhone in comparison to the AT&T iPhone, but I don't think that's going to surprise any of you. Primarily, the differences between GSM and CDMA technology. Like I said, CDMA is more reliable. Now, when we transition to 4G, that's really not going to matter so much because they're all going to be the same, but we don't anticipate Apple moving that direction for a couple of years. But what makes CDMA in the iPhone possible? It's the new Qualcomm MDM6600 chip, which is surprising because it supports both GSM and CDMA. If it sounds familiar, it's because Motorola's Droid Pro shipped with the same chip back in October of 2010. They're calling it a world phone because it allows customers to have voice coverage in almost every country in the world. One phone to use all over the world sounds wonderful, but this phone only supports CDMA. Why is that? Could it be that Apple's thinking of using this chip in iPad 2? Or maybe when iPhone 5 is released, there'll be one phone for both Verizon and AT&T? That'd be great. We can't tell just yet, but what we can tell is while the chip supports both GSM and CDMA, there's no modding this phone to work on AT&T. This isn't just a case where Apple took a CDMA chip and slapped it into the iPhone and called it Verizon. They actually redesigned the entire logic board, including the electromagnetic shields. Apple's RF engineering team did a great job at restructuring the antenna, so hopefully we don't have the same death grip problem that saddles its AT&T brother. So, how repairable is the Verizon iPhone? I'm going to say it's just about as repairable as the AT&T iPhone. Almost all of the parts are replaceable, except they use those pesky Pentalobe screws to keep us out. We've got a lot more technical information and high-resolution photos in the Verizon iPhone Teardown on our site. For all the latest teardowns and repair guides, you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/ifixityourself. And if you do the Twitter thing, you can follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/ifixit. Thanks for watching, and happy repairing!